Today, the study released by the Royal College of Physicians highlights that Oxford is ranked amongst the most polluted cities in the UK and exceeding the World Health Organization's recommended limit values for particulate matter smaller than 2.5 microns. So we could basically be facing an even more serious situation than the one which we already know kills three times more people than AIDS, malaria, and TB combined. But as it stands, this is a global crisis which threatens the survival of human societies, according to the Lancet's report. And it requires response at all levels, from international, national, and local. The UN and the WHO have a responsibility to set standards based on the best available science for our governments to follow. Our national governments have obligations to put strategies in place capable of meeting those standards and to work with local authorities, and not, as our government seems to be intent on, shifting the blame onto local authorities and the responsibility for actually turning around the situation. As a member of the European Parliament's committees on transport and the environment, I'm confronted on a daily basis with the tensions between needing to improve mobility across Europe and the impact that this has on our air and our resources and the planet's climate. Brussels and London, two cities between which I regularly travel, are proven to be amongst the most polluted and congested cities in all of Europe. Our transport sector is on an unsustainable path, that risks our climate and our health. So I'm pleased to see that we're finally witnessing an increasing awareness in the UK of the broad range of adverse health effects and increased mortality that results from air pollution. I think a lot of the credit has got to go down to Climate Earth, the legal team that has taken the British government to the highest courts in the land and actually won the case to say, actually, what you're doing isn't going to be a solution in any way to the problems. So strong laws are the best tools that we have to protect our health and the environment. The EU has been an overwhelming force for good in this respect. For as long as Britain remains in the EU, we will be subject to legislation that sets air quality limits. If these are exceeded, member states are required to adopt and implement air quality plans that set out an appropriate measure to bring pollutants back within safe limits as soon as possible. But Brexit may mean an end to all this, because the UK will only be bound by the judgments of the ECJ, the European Court of Justice, for as long as it remains a member of the EU. And this is one of Theresa May's red line issues, that she doesn't want to be subject controlled by the European courts. And the European courts oversee the directives and regulations. So, although the targets would remain technically in effect in the UK, the EU would no longer have the role in enforcement, and the government, well, in fact, would be free to change the laws, or repeal them, or reduce the increase the tolerated levels, and only serve to increase a public health emergency that cuts short so many lives, and into the bargain, it costs the British taxpayer £20 billion a year. Indeed, that's why we're on the subject of spending taxpayers' money. I don't know how many noticed the government has come up and confessed that it used £370,000 of taxpayers' money to defend the legal challenge from Client Earth. All that money could have been useful, more usefully spent trying to make a difference to our air quality, not to actually cover the backs of prime ministers and ministers. This year, in May, I published a report which highlights some of the shortcomings of the government's draft UK air quality plan by analysing the effect that it might have on air quality in four major cities. And Brighton and Hove was one, Bristol, London and Oxford. There's a copy of that outside on that table, I think. Please don't leave here without one, because it's kind of my contribution, the Greens' contribution, to highlighting the problems, but also investigating the solutions. I think that the report will talk about the UK law must meet and keep pace with the EU air quality laws and legal limits, and that is a minimum. Britain needs a new Clean Air Act, and your former County Councillor Caroline Lucas is leading the call for that. We need better monitoring of more pollutants and a more consistent reporting of data by local authorities, as well as more research on lesser known and poorly understood pollutants. We need to introduce a targeted diesel scrappage scheme, and we need to think through efficient and environmentally friendly urban freight transport systems to try and reduce the congestion on our city's roads. And additionally, we should integrate the cities as proper actors. When government is trying to find a way forward, it should actually be listening to the cities in this country and not just sort of ploughing their own furrow, as they say. So we need thinking people to come up with solutions at every level. And I think Chris will talk more about what's happening in Oxford, but I just want to reflect on what's happened here already to address this issue, thanks to the local Green Party's and councillors' campaigning, pressure and action. Oxford really has done really well. It's through the work of local Greens over the last 15 years. The 10-point action plan that the Greens set out in 2004 was the starting point for over a decade of action to tackle air pollution in Oxford. Oxford was the first place outside London to introduce a low emission zone and 20-mile-an-hour zones, which are in place across most of the city. These efforts, fought for and implemented by the Greens, should be celebrated as air quality has slowly improved in this city. But much more needs to be done. As this problem continues to cause a public health crisis that requires urgent action, we need green thinking policymakers in place to push for the level of action on this issue that is so desperately required. As they continue, the council's current council continues to fall far short in this regard. Oxford remains one of the top 15 most polluted cities in the UK. And hotspots in the city are having a hugely negative effect on both the most deprived and the residents who have contributed least to making this problem. Air pollution is not only a public health emergency in Oxford, it is an issue of social justice. Moreover, that upgraded Westgate shopping centre with its new parking infrastructure has the potential to undo all of the positive things and progress made here so far, and undermine the efforts to promote public transport. Oxford Council needs to do more, and we need green politicians, I'd be bold enough to say. We need politicians, green thinking and green party, to making those decisions to ensure that improving air quality becomes a policy priority. The current consultation on whether to ban petrol and diesel cars from the city centre is positive, but only if it leads the council to deliver a zero emission zone. It's difficult to take their proposals seriously when the council's also expanding car parking in the city centre and reducing parking charges. These plans are guaranteed to increase the traffic congestion and ultimately make pollution worse in already the most affected areas. So looking for the prognosis for the planet, I know it's a bit wider than Oxford, but it seems to be the case that a lot of places are suffering the same challenges. The threat and impacts of pollution are not being taken seriously. Measures are implemented which worsen, not improve the situation. And that's every day. And as I wrote in the my recent response to the consultation on Oxfordshire's infrastructure strategy, only joined up long-term thinking in policy making is acceptable now. We need to consider the environmental, economic and social considerations of all the decisions that are taken in our name. And without such concerted effort across all levels, pollution will continue to be the uncontrolled and growing plague of the 21st century. The way the world is living will not only kill the planet, it will kill a lot of people on the planet. And I think we actually need to take action, starting today, starting in Oxford, immediately, to halt this disaster.